Hello, greetings. So this is going to be a Gordian topic because it's been a while. And also, I've been discussing this topic online lately, but I have made a video about something similar that also touches in on this, namely the role of free women within the Gordian lifestyle. I feel that this topic has to be addressed again because of massive misconceptions about this area. Now, I do realize that there are a lot of people who have sort of beaten this idea into their heads, and no matter how much fact you give them, no matter what you do or say or prove or show, they will never give it up. So this video is not really for them. This video for everybody else who might have questions about this. Now, what are the topics I am referring to? The little idea that a woman is only free as long as a man allows her to. Now, I do warn you, this might be somewhat of a long video because I have some things to say. So, I also have to warn you that if you have a problem with sighing, snarky free women, or in otherwise somebody challenging your ideas about being a Gordian, you probably shouldn't watch this video because there will be a lot of that. Okay, to the topic. So, there is a quote in the Gord books that says, "A woman is only free as long as it pleases a man." I am not sure if the quote is completely accurate, because remembering quotes accurately is not necessarily my strength, but it is basically what it's saying. Many people have then taken this to mean that a free woman can be enslaved by any man at any point in time. I mean, to the point that there's one free man I spoke to that said, no, a free woman should not contact the police if a Gordian tries to kidnap her, because it's his right to make a woman his slave if he wants to. Now, let me try to address some fallacies here. Let's look at the setting first. And I will later address the meaning of this quote and what it actually means for the philosophy. But let's start with the setting. There are no places on Gore, any of the city states with on Gore, where you can just march up to a woman and enslave her. The possible exception is Tarna after some of the male liberation there, but that's sort of a special case. Women are citizens, just as men are, and while there are laws that will allow her to be enslaved if she breaks them and so on and so forth, you cannot just go to your neighbor's door, knock on it and say, "Oh, you know what? I like your eyes. You're not my slave." No, you can't do that, because then the city guards will come and run your horny ass through with a sword. And even a free companion can't do that, because while a free companion do have the right to punish his companion, basically he is the head of the household, and if he feels the need to, he can punish his companion. He cannot just enslave her, and she has the right to not renew the companionship contract when the year is up, and so leave him. Now, there are quite a few laws that will allow a woman to be enslaved, and some of these do not also apply to men. First of all, you have a lot of laws where a man will be executed while a woman be enslaved. For example, theft. If you steal something on Gore, and we're talking about within the fiction here, the fictional characters, the first time your heir is nicked, if you steal something a second time, a man will be executed and a woman enslaved. But there are also a few things that doesn't work the other way around. If a man owns a slave, a male slave, female slave, whatever slave, and a free woman sleeps with that slave, he has the right to enslave her. This doesn't go the other way around in most cities. It's not like if she owns a slave and a man sleeps with that slave, she doesn't have the right to enslave him. However, while there are a bit of a skewed law there, if a free woman hasn't broken any laws and hasn't acted very slavely, she cannot just be grabbed off the street and enslaved without that breaking law. And it's also this that many say that, but that's not what it means. It means that it's the lawmakers. That's basically the lawmakers are for the most part men. And if they decide to change the law that all women may be enslaved, then they can do that. So therefore, it's men that chooses women to be free. Yeah, but this is the same for men. There are one of the cities, the one that I mentioned earlier, Tarna, where basically, if a man stays within the city more than 24 hours, I think it was that, or was it 48 hours? Anyway, more than a certain amount of time, he's automatically enslaved. And that's just how the law works there. So this will also apply to a man. And then you have between cities, basically how society in within these novels works. You have city-states. They are individual units, ruled by a king or a council or whatever that particular state, city is ruled by. Between this, it's do whatever the fuck you want land. So, basically, if you travel around there and somebody decides, I think I like her ass, I want to make her a slave. There's no law that prevents them from rushing up and grabbing you. However, there isn't a law that prevents a woman from doing that with a man either. There are actually scenes within the books where you have a female slaver who picks up the main characters of that book and enslaves them. Of course, this being gore, this goes badly for her when they escape and things get out of hand, but she does. And it's completely within her right to do so. However, of course, within gore you have the concept of might makes right. And really that is the law of nature. And since men generally are stronger than women, and also a fair number of warrior men receives combat training, something most women do not, it is easier for a man to kidnap and enslave a woman than it is for a woman to do the same with a man. But that doesn't mean that the law says he can do it, she can't do it. Now also, here's a very, very, very important thing that a lot of people seem to forget. Slavery is always a choice. Basically, you can always fight and die, or pretend to surrender and then wait until your new master sleeps and then murder him in his sleep. And basically die rather than becoming a slave. And this is the same for women. And actually there are a common practice that when you sack a city, you give the free women there the choice between slavery and death, and it is considered honorable for women then to choose death. And there are examples in the books of women that chooses death over slavery. They were never enslaved. It was never anybody's choice to make them a slave. They took their freedom, just the same as a man can do. Now, here's the point. It is easier to basically, or let me rephrase that. More women than men would be willing to live a relatively comfortable life in slavery than to die or endure a lot of torture to try to not surrender than men. But that doesn't mean there aren't men who are willing to be slaves over that. This actually also happens in this series. Men who are captured and made slaves. So, basically, if you actually read the books, this quote doesn't fit reality within the books. Yes, a lot of women are made slaves. However, none of the cities, with the possible exception of Tarna post-male revolution, can you just enslave a free woman? And this goes a little bit back to the main debate with that free man who thought that a woman shouldn't call the police. Well, actually, a Gorian lifestyler is the citizen of whatever nation and city she lives in, and just like a free woman on Gore can call the city guards to help protect her, a free woman on Earth can call the police to help protect her. But yes, there's none of those cities practice, yes, you can just grab a woman. Two, while you can grab people when they are traveling between cities, both men and women can do that. Of course, it is easier for men to do it. And, yeah. Now, let us also remember one thing when it comes to gore books. They are exaggerated. You cannot just take whatever is in them and just plop it down into real life and live that. Just some, in addition to the, we don't have the aliens and the science fiction technology and such. They are exaggerated. Think of it a bit like when you're going to the theater. If you are on the first row and you look directly at the actors, you will see that their makeup and such are, the eyes are just take full of makeup. Everything is exaggerated so that the people farthest back in the theater shall be able to see them. And it is the same thing within the novels. Basically, it is novels about the natural order of male domination and female submission. However, this has to be exaggerated to make the point. Look at, for example, the sizes. Normally, women are about give or take 10% smaller than males. And, but in the gore books, all the men are huge. They are Conan the Barbarian. They are 6'6" and taller, enormous muscles. They are hunking mountains of man meat. And all the women are small, delicate, 5 feet and less, tiny, 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 tiny little women. Now, this is just how the entire population is. But here's what would happen if hunking piece of man meat mates with tiny, tiny, tiny little elf woman. They get offspring that usually are somewhere in between. And then these offspring have offspring that is also somewhere in between, and not before too many generations you have something, well, in between. And you get something that is basically that men are roughly 10% bigger than women. However, this is exaggerated in the books to show that the women are weaker and more helpless than the men, and the men are strong and manly. Because the lesson is there, but it is exaggerated to make people understand it. The same with, for example, there's a scene where you have these big birthed a slave. I mean, this huge, huge, muscular slave woman. And they wanted to show that, oh no, all men are weak, are stronger than all women. So they have give her a knife, and have send in this tiny, 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 tiny little wimpy slave boy. And he, of course, have her beaten down and tied up in 5 seconds flat, snap. Now, reality-wise, he would have had his balls cut off by Big Bertha pretty quickly. Because in reality, while men are on average bigger than women, and are on average stronger than women, that doesn't mean that that is always the case. I, for example, know quite a few men that I am physically stronger than. So, yeah, but it is exaggerated to prove a point. And such is also basically the romantic idea that a woman is only free as long as a man allows her. That isn't meant to be taken as a literal thing that all should live by. That somehow, if you consider yourself to be a free woman, then if you have a knock on the door and there stands some dweeb that has slapped the Gorian name on his shoulder there and says, well, hello ma'am, you're now my slave. It doesn't mean that you should just surrender to him. It isn't meant like that. It is meant to be a romantication of an idea. Now, like I said, I was going to explain it within the philosophical term, and I will do that now. Basically, you have two very important things that go into this quote. One is that women are more malleable than men and have a tendency to be less interested, it'll be less concerned about freedom rather than comfort. Basically, we have developed, and if you look quite a bit back in our history, common thing were to kidnap brides. They would, the men of neighboring villages would just rush in, grab the women, drag them back home, and make them their mates. And women generally accepted this. And we come from those women. So that it is more natural for us to accept such a thing. And also, women are programmed from nature's point to be less willing to sacrifice themselves. Because originally human beings lived in small tribes and family units. And if that tribe lost a female, a fertile female, that was a huge blow. Because the bottleneck in reproduction lies with the females. Basically, a woman, of course, then needs 6 months to produce an offspring, while a man can do it in 5 minutes. And as such, one man can impregnate a lot of women. The bottleneck is by the women. So if the tribe lost a few men, there's always somebody to take their place. If the tribe lost a female, however, that would be very bad. Therefore, women are less likely to sacrifice itself. Men also needed more courage and willing to sacrifice themselves because they were the one that went out to hunt the mammoths and other big things to bring home the bacon. Women also then more naturally attach themselves to a leader and a protector that could slay the mammoths for her, and she was then more adaptable. Basically, the strategy of the human race, if you look at every animal, it has survival strategies, and the survival strategy was the females have to keep themselves safe and find a male to protect and care for her. And then she was submissive to that male. As such, it is more instinctual for more women that if she is given the choice between slavery and death, more women will choose slavery. And even if a woman is left between the choice of freedom or basically slavery or discomfort, she will very often choose comfortable slavery. And we can see this when we, for example, see debates today about security measures. Far more men than women in Norway right now, and in quite a big part of Europe, we have something that is called the Data Storage Directive, which basically says that a lot of the electronic data we leave behind are stored. A lot more men than women are outraged at this, because women feel that the little bit of extra security they get is worth that, that is worth the privacy and freedom by sacrifice, while more men feel that it is not worth that freedom. And of course this isn't always so. There are men that feel that sacrificing freedom for security is completely okay, and women who feel it is not okay. But if you look at it statistically, more women are willing to accept it. And we can also look at, for example, I'm not sure what the books are called, but they were basically in the 30s, I think it was. They went around and interviewed a lot of former slaves in the United States. And they call this slave documentary, something like that. And there's a lot, there are, for example, a married couple there. And she was owned by somebody who treated his slaves very well. And she would have preferred to stay a slave, because she would rather live in bondage, but in comfort, where she had enough to eat and had a dry and nice place to stay and were treated kindly, than to live free but in poverty. Of course, this wasn't all the women there, but it's we see it in history that women are more likely to accept losses of freedom for security. Therefore, a man who can offer security will often make a woman willingly give up her freedom. And a man who offers to take away security unless a woman gives up her freedom is also likely to have her comply. That's one of the things that quote means. So, yeah. Basically, a woman is less likely to fight to the death to remain free. The other thing that is meant is that basically men generally then on gore have all the positions of power, and as such they can easier make rulings that will hinder a woman's freedom. And however, the other thing that is within the basically philosophical part is that more women than men are submissive. And as such, more women would want to become a slave if that is offered. It is more natural for women to offer such a surrender. Basically, the quote is not meant as a to be taken literally. Yes, all women are subject to all men. If you have a penis, you can take any owned woman and make her a slave on your whim. However, basically you have might makes rights, which just makes it easier for men to enslave women on Gore. And women are more likely to be willing to accept a comfortable slavery over an uncomfortable freedom, or over death. Men are more likely to say, fuck that, I'll rather starve than be a slave. Or fuck that, I'll rather die than be a slave. That, however, doesn't mean that all women would do that. That is also a way that the books are exaggerated. The book speaks of, this is how men are, this is how women are. But it doesn't work that way. That is an exaggeration. Basically, you can say that a majority of women are like this, a majority of men are like that. However, there are no thing that you can say about one gender that would be true for every member of said gender. So, yeah. Now, the video is going on, I see, but I have a few more things to say. Let us also look, just to lay this thing to rest, let us also look at the, some of the societies that the Gore books were based on. Because John Norman did not just pull everything in the Gore books out of his ass. He did take a lot of the works of other philosophers. He took the concepts and values of several older societies and just added a bit of his own flair, mixed this well up, and voila, the Gorean philosophy. So let's look at some of these, shall we? Let's look at, for example, Sparta. Spartan women had a particular rope in their hair. This rope was meant then that if the city they lived in was sacked, they would tighten it around their neck and then start burning the city down. The reason why they would do this was that those that sacked the city would not get any spoils, physical spoils of war, and they would not get them as spoils of war. So they chose to die rather than be slaves. Within Roman ideals, slavery was always seen as a choice. Basically, it was seen as a much better and more honorable choice both for men and women to be willing to kill yourself or fight to the death rather than accept slavery. It was seen that by your survival, you accepted it. So a woman within within Roman society who killed herself rather than become a slave would be honored. And then if you're willing to die for freedom, no one can take that away from you. Because here's the case for both men and women. Freedom is not given. It's taken. Basically, most of the free women within the Gore books, they are slaves. They might have the title free, but they aren't free. They are sold like so much cattle by their fathers. They are willing to give all of that up to become slaves if they are pressured. They are slaves with privilege. However, some of the Panther girls, some of those women that are willing to be beheaded rather than accept bondage, those are free. And yes, there are quite few then truly free women, but that doesn't mean that if you are truly free woman, no, your freedom is not given to you by a man. You take it just like a man do, because the concept of freedom doesn't change whatever or not you have a penis. The concept, the ideal of freedom is the same whatever gender you are. It's just more likely that a man will strive to attain that ideal of freedom than that a woman will. Now, moving on. For example, look at Norse society. Women often were expected to defend the homesteads while their men were out in week. And also, for example, Queen Åsa, she was kidnapped, and it is most historians agree that she killed the man that married her against her will, and she was celebrated from it. Basically, she didn't accept that slavery, though of course she wasn't slave by name. He made her his queen, but it was still with, basically without her consent, and he took away her freedom. And she refused it and killed him. And this made her one of the women that was most celebrated within Viking society. So, and just to mention it, basically within Viking society, the second highest position within their tribal society were reserved for women, for the Volva. A Volva is a shaman, a sorceress, and a priestess of the old gods. And only the chieftains stood over her in rank. And basically also within Viking society, a woman could give up the protections a woman had and attain the right of a man and become a shield maiden. Now a shield maiden was as respected as a man, she had the same rights as a man, though she did not have the rights of a woman. And so basically, while Viking society did accept that women are basically the weaker gender, and women were submissive to men, they also accepted that there are women that demands the freedom that were afforded to men, and they had a chance to attain that. So, basically, if you look at this, the societies that the Gore books are based on do not have the concept that a woman can be enslaved by a man at any point in time. The society within the books do not follow this ideal. It doesn't happen within the books in that way. Yes, a lot of women get enslaved, but it is because they either break the law or they get kidnapped and then choose slavery over death. And within real life, it doesn't work that way. Because basically why a lot of women would be willing to surrender their freedom, not all would. A lot of us would actually be willing to fight to the death to protect that freedom. And that means that we are truly free and we have taken that freedom. It is not given to us. So, basically, what are these quotes worth? It is an ideal. It is a romantication. That's what it is. It is a romantic idea to basically say women are generally weaker than men. They generally value freedom less than men. And that basically men are the stronger gender. That is what the quote says. It should not be taken as, no, if you are a Gorian lifestyler, you should have to surrender to any Tom, Dick, and Harry that happens to want to have you as a sex slave. So, yeah. And you are all completely free to look up the books and do tell me that I'm wrong. That there isn't laws against just randomly enslaving people within a city. Do tell me that I'm wrong, that these societies didn't value more that a woman fought for her freedom than blindly surrendering. And do please look at anything when it comes to human behavior and so on, and tell me that all women are the same. And all women would accept slavery like that. And therefore, freedom is handed to them or not. Because freedom that is handed to you, that is just a word, it isn't freedom. But if you cannot tell me, show me proof that these things are wrong, then you have interpreted these books wrong? You either are thinking with your dick, or you are afraid of women and just want to live in the fantasy land that all women should bow to you if you just decide to make them a slave. Or C, you are misunderstanding the fiction for what you can actually do with reality. So, yeah. Now, of course, there's a lot of people that's gonna say, oh, you know, of course, if you send me in this, you are not truly Gregorian. And to those, I say, please, take that opinion and show it up your bumhole. Read a bit about human behavior. Now, yes, I do agree with the Gregorian philosophy that basically, in most cases, the natural thing is for a woman to be submissive to a man. I also do think that slavery is the ultimate expression of femininity. That, however, do not mean that all women will or should accept such expression, or that all women are submissive because all women are not. That you have a statistical, that more women statistically are away, do not mean that all women are that way. So, yes, when you are taking a fictional book and making it into a lifestyle, you have to fit the fiction to reality, not try to beat reality into the fiction, and especially not a quote that isn't practiced that way within the fiction either. Now, do I sound a bit animated on this? Yes, I do. Why do I sound a bit animated with it? Because I am sick and tired of being told that I am free because somehow Mr. I Have a Penis allows it. No, I am free because I am willing to fight, bleed, and die. Remain free. And if you desire to challenge this and come to my doorstep and try to enslave me, you are welcome to do so. However, do be prepared to end up in the hospital for quite some time. Now, thank you for watching my video. If you have been watching all the 37 minutes, I commend you. You obviously think this is worth listening to. If not, then have a nice day either way. Hope you have enjoyed this video. Have a great day and blessed be.